During the last elections, we know so many great names had been flaunted before the people, before the electorate, as potential prime ministerial candidates. But the entire media, the people at large, the whole nation had been debating in public and private who will be the best prime ministerial material. And they had to make a choice of their own. And we find that that choice has not so far proved wrong. So it is in the same way I would like to compare Brother Julius, who has also established his credentials as one of the performing directors of the school, a brilliant person, a leader material, and a director material. I'm so happy that the school has now completing 10 years, and we are in the midst of the decennial celebrations of this celebrity institution of learning. 10 years is not a long period for an institution, but at the same time, it is not too small a period either. 10 years is enough to make our own assessment, and 10 years is enough to plan for future. I'm sure by knowing the records of achievement that St. Francis School have gained during the last 10 years, because of the teamwork of the management, of the directors, of the principals, of the headmistress, of the teachers, non-teaching staff and the parents, as also the brilliant students, the promises for our future. They have proved that this school is one about which we all can be rightfully proud of. But education, whatever be the percentage of pass, or the number of classes, or distinctions that we acquire, ultimately is tested on what type of characters we build for our students and how we send them equipped for life in the society. What is in fact education? Education is training them to see the one who lives next to him or her. Some time back, I had an occasion of reading a small piece of a story, an event, which was published in the Reader's Digest, which simply said about what had happened in 1946, 6 months before or 7 months before the nation had stepped into her independence. The story told us that a train was coming and halting at a suburban railway station in Calcutta, just a few kilometers away from the main Calcutta station. And it was a morning. Many of the passengers had gone out to the platform for taking a tea or buying a newspaper. And in those days, the trains were being run on the basis of three whistles. Once the train has come and halted at a railway station, it was leaving that station after three whistles. The first whistle was a warning whistle, and a second whistle, and on the third whistle, the train used to leave the station. And this train also had halted there for 5 minutes. Then came the first warning whistle. And so many of the passengers who had gone out, either for their tea or for purchasing something, they were rushing back to the compartments. and an old lady whom the Reader's Digest say a village woman, a hunchback, physically deformed one, carrying a heavy trunk, was struggling to get into a compartment. She was not wearing any chappal. She was in very dirty dress and she was alone. And the passengers who were traveling in the compartment were seeing her hardship in getting into the compartment. But nobody moved. And then the second whistle came. And a young boy of 18 or 19 who was coming to that station by traveling in the same compartment, he was rushing back. And he saw the old lady struggling so hard to enter. What he did was he immediately took the heavy trunk from her and put it into the compartment. Then he offered his helping hand for her. But she could not still enter the compartment because of her physical deformity. And then the boy offered her that he will kneel down and she must step onto his shoulders and get into the compartment, as on the third whistle the train will start moving. The lady was unwilling, because the boy was wearing a very fine white shirt and she was not even wearing a chappal. Her foot was dirty. And then the boy was very angry and told her that unless you get on, the train will move. The lady had no other option. She put her steps on the shoulders of the boy and got into the compartment, and the train left on the third whistle. All the passengers were witnesses to this event. Once the train left the station, after a little time, an Englishman who was sitting in the same compartment, who saw all this, had called the boy aside. He did not compliment him or congratulate him. He did not mention what he had done. He simply asked him, what was his name? The boy said, Nilotpal Das. He was a Bengali boy. The second question the Englishman put to the boy was, what you are doing? The boy said he was studying in a college and he named the college in Calcutta. Nothing more, nothing less. After half an hour, the train reached the main station of Calcutta and all dispersed. After a month's time, the principal of that college received a communication from the registrar of the University of Oxford, informing the principal that the student Nilotpal Das has been awarded one of the most prestigious fellowships of Oxford for his higher studies. The principal was in a dilemma. And he could not believe that, because he thought, as most principals will be, that the boy might have played some trick in cheating the university and getting the scholarship. So without informing the student of what had happened, the principal wrote back to the university registrar that, sir, I am afraid the boy has been awarded this fellowship by some misunderstanding, because the boy is not even a graduate. Then came the second letter as a reply to what the principal had wrote to the university. And in the second letter, it was said what had happened. The registrar narrated what had happened on that suburban railway station on that day. and informed the principal that the English man who saw all these was the science dean of the university. On return to Oxford, he reported the story to the board of governors of the university and recommended for awarding this prestigious Oxford fellowship to the boy. And as the last paragraph of the reply to the principal, the registrar mentioned in that letter, "You have said in your letter that the boy was not even a graduate, but the University of Oxford deemed that dusty footprints on that white shirt of the boy on that day as a higher degree conferred by any university in the world." This is education. This is what I would like to convey to my young, promising boys and girls of the St. Francis School. God bless the school. Thank you very much.
The year 2013 saw our first batch of class 12 pass the examination conducted by the CBSE with flying colors. That year, we had just 19 students. In the year 2014, our batch consisted of 46 students. The Achievers Award ceremony is held to felicitate the outstanding performers in the AISSCE. This year, we are having it as a part of our annual function. I request our chief guest to give away the awards.
A sincere student, and also one of the nightingales of St. Francis School. She was a perfectionist always. A dancer, a polite, friendly, and well-behaved student, all molded into one. Ayushi Bahuguna is not just the school topper with 95% marks, but also the highest scorer in three subjects, 98% in business studies, 95% in economics, and 92% in accountancy. I call upon the stage the school topper for the academic year 2013-14. Ayushi is pursuing an honors degree in economics from Daulat Ram College, Delhi University. Congratulations, Ayushi. He has the ability to crack the most difficult maths problems using simple tricks, with the mind of a genius and a sweet smile on his face. Anubhav Sukul went ahead to top the school in second position with 92.4% in the science stream. And no surprise, the highest scorer in maths with 96%. Our very own Ramanujan could not be present here today, since he's pursuing a degree in civil engineering from the Indian Institute of Engineering, Science and Technology, Calcutta. So I request his parents, Mr. and Mrs. Sukul, to receive the award on his behalf. Thank you, ma'am. A classical dancer and shy by nature, Anika Tomichan was a very quiet student in the classroom, but her pen spoke a lot for her in the examination. She stands third among the toppers with 92.2% marks in the science stream. Anika has also scored the highest marks in physics with 92%. Anika is pursuing a degree in electric and electronic engineering from the Rajgiri School of Engineering and Technology, Kochi, and thus could not be present today. I request her parents, Mr. and Mrs. Tomichan, to receive the award on her behalf. Those were the three school toppers. We have three more subject toppers. A gentle person and a computer whiz. Ankit Kumar Singh was the brain behind the computerization of the school elections. No surprise that he topped in IP